But since I'm here in person, we thought it
Can't hear you. This is Chris Schmaltz. You're cutting in and out.
Yeah, we can't hear online.
I think they're working on some audio issues in the room.
Thank you.
Okay, can everyone hear me?
Yes, I can.
I heard that, yep.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, good. I'm still hearing an echo. Okay, I'm gonna call the meeting to order. Welcome everybody, Mary. We hope to get through the guiding principles and the goals today. As you may recall, that the board asked us to please have them finished by our next meeting. So before we do that, I'd like to see if everyone has had a chance to look at the meeting summary. Okay, I will entertain a motion to approve.
I'll make a motion to approve the meeting summary.
I second that motion.
Okay. Any discussion, changes? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Aye.
Okay. On to the next item. Aki, were there any public comments submitted?
No public comments were submitted today.
Okay, just saved us a half an hour. Okay, so Paki, you are going to be giving a presentation on where we are with the guiding principles.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair, for today. So just as we did at the last CAC meeting, we took the input and feedback that you provided on the guiding principles, on the six guiding principles, and we revised the red lines. So this presentation are the new red lines as of last meeting that you can discuss and confirm, have additional discussion on, and then move on to the goals afterward. Crystal, do I have control? Thank you. So here is guiding principle number one. The last meeting, the discussion was that a future RTA plan should improve the performance of the regional network, prioritize regional impactful projects, and focus on regional needs and goals. The discussion is up to you to agree with this guiding principle based on these red lines, or have further discussion.
Each guiding principle.
What was that?
Should we go through each one to get?
That's what I did last time. If I just go through all of them all at once, that's fine. I was just going through each one to see if you had any additional revisions or if you agree on the red lines that you agreed on at the last meeting.
Yes, Abby.
I'm wondering if we can see them all together.
I'm sorry, I cannot hear the person in the room.
all at the same time because we had some discussion about what the clearest way to break them down was before we start wordsmithing each individual one. I think that'd be easiest.
And also, if this is a revision, what does the original look like? Like, where's the change?
In the packet, the red line is in the packet of materials.
Yeah, everything is in the packet, including any additional feedback that we you received on these. What I have on the slides today is the most recent red lines.
Okay, so what was this? How did this read before? I mean, I see it in red line, but I was wondering how it read. What's the change?
It's an add.
It's a totally new.
Yeah.
It's not an add. This is removing the, this was changing. Hang on, I'm trying to pull it up. I think what folks were trying to say is more that it would be helpful to have these more side by side so that it is easier to review as we're having this discussion. But it was something like, oh gosh, trying to go back and find it. It was just a revision of the first one that used to say something like, you know, should, you know, and like improve regionally significant, or you know, should provide regionally significant projects or something like that. And so this was more of a elaboration of that and clarification of what the regional network and what would be like regionally significant versus impactful.
Taffy, do you, this is Chris. Do you have a, sorry, Madam Chair. Do you have the page from the packet that shows the entire document?
It's 7.
Yeah, but page 7 doesn't show what this used to look like, this one bullet specifically.
Mr. Chair and members, I am expectedly home today and I do not have the packet in front of me. I can pull it up electronically. It'll just be a little challenging for me to toggle back and forth. I was under the impression that today's discussion was going to focus on the revisions that were agreed on from last time, but I can certainly try and pull that up or at least look at it. I don't know if I can pull it up, but I can try and look at them. Tom?
Yeah, I have the original ones here. I can read them to you. This one just said, should prioritize regionally significant transportation needs and focus on regional projects. And we wordsmithed it, I guess, based on feedback that we got at the meeting and after, as people wrote what their version of it was or what they had heard. So
it's a replacement for that original bullet.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for reading that.
So would everybody feel comfortable going through these as suggested by Pocky? And if we need to repeat the original guiding principle as we go down, it sounds like Tom has them in front of him. So is everybody okay with this new language?
I just have one.
Yes.
Madam Chair?
Yes. Diane.
And I look on page 8 or the next page where the definition of regional or regionally impactful, not clear that we've actually clarified that. So when I hear regional network, regional needs, do we have that in our guidelines?
Pocky?
Yes.
Were you going to be going over the definitions that the response from staff for the definitions of particular words and phrases that we are unsure of? Because it was included in our packet.
Sorry, there's a very, very bad echo and shriek. I only have today on the slides the revisions, but I can... It's up to the committee if you want to discuss the other item that was in your packet.
Okay. Well, what I'd like to suggest is we try to go through them, and if there are questions about the original language, perhaps Tom can have a hand. But That be okay, Tom?
Yep, that's fine.
Okay. So is everyone okay with this language that we see in red for the first guiding principle? Are there anybody?
There are a couple of hands up, Carol.
Hands up. Eva?
Oh, I just wanted to get a little clarity. So the proposed revisions in red, these are the revisions that we made last time, or these are the TMC revisions? Like, is there a differentiation, or are they just all together? Like, what are we looking at exactly? Sorry, I've been on vacation for 2 weeks and I can't remember anything from before the last 2 weeks.
Understand. No,
if I may, Mr. Yes. Chair, Madam Chair, these are the revisions from the last CAC meeting. TMC feedback is not included in these red lines. The TMC feedback is included in your packet.
And Moss?
I just wanted to try to address Diane's question, which I think is a good one that we've brought up a couple times about the definition. And I was looking at staff's response, which is on page 8 of the meeting packet, if anybody else has it open, about how, which essentially says that any definition of regional or regionally impactful will be subjective per staff. However, per staff, a working definition will become apparent during an iterative process based on general consensus. And I just wanted to throw out there, you know, in response to these staff statements, that there are examples in other communities of defining regionally significant and impactful projects. One that I found recently was the MPO, so PAGS equivalent in Chicago. They had done an entire webpage, which I'm happy to share with folks, about how they defined and evaluated what regionally significant projects were. And they used federal guidelines that, you know, are empowering MPOs to determine that. And so I think that what I might offer for our group in this moment is placing this in the framework, and then in the evaluation of projects, that subcommittee that's formed, that being a moment of where we would be defining that and using that to guide our formal definition of regional network and impactful projects and such like that. Since those will help prioritize the projects through that tool that will be created. And then we as a larger committee could talk about how use that as a way to kind of run through all the projects. So I just wanted to offer that for us to consider, because I know that this definition piece has been a sticking point and it doesn't have to be subjective in my perspective. So thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Moss. That sounds like a good idea. Is that okay with you, Diane? Okay. So are we ready to move on from guiding principle number one? Everybody, if there's anybody else who wants to say anything, please say it now. Okay, thank you. Aki?
Okay, guiding principle number two, the revisions that were made are a future RTA plan must include an implementation timeline and identify specific projects as well as categorical elements, is the way that this was revised based on the last CAC meeting.
Okay, any discussion on this one?
The only change from last time is must is now should. And these were based on looking back at, as staff taking a look at the statute and trying to define where the statute is, requiring an action or simply allowing it.
Thank you, Tom. Anyone else? Good. Sounds like we have. Can I get an approval on this one as we move forward? Are there any objections?
We're going to do Madam Chair, we're going to do a single vote on the whole statement, right? So.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, moving on to number three.
So on this guiding principle, a future RTA plan must identify an implementation budget based on projected excise revenues, local funding commitments, and other funding sources, including maintenance funding commitments secured from each responsible jurisdiction in the taxing district prior to plan approval. This is the guiding principle that incorporated the last guiding principle on the previous revisions. So two guiding principles were merged into one for this one.
Okay, thank you. Any discussion? Any revisions?
So, Madam Chair, this is Jamie. Yes. So the TNC makes some recommendations also. We don't discuss these at this time, or doesn't it kind of make sense to maybe look at their recommendation as well? Provides more clarity.
I'm sorry, I couldn't understand all that.
So in page 10 of the packet, the TMC made some recommended revisions to our framework or guiding principles. Should we look at those at the same time?
I was thinking we could go through all of these and then we can have a discussion about the TMC suggestions.
Okay.
But I'm willing to do it all now if everybody thinks that's better. Did everyone see the TMC? Everyone see the TMC suggested revisions?
Yep.
Three different members. It would be great to do it the best, most efficient way possible. So I think we can either have us go through all of these now with our own changes and then discuss whether or not all of theirs. Or we can do them all at the same time. What would the committee like to do? Yes.
I would think it's simpler just to do these first and then come back.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I just want to clarify. So the comments you received were from three individual members. At the next TMC meeting, they will discuss it as a committee. So whatever you come up with today, they will discuss it as a committee at their next meeting, and then they would make recommendations to the board as well. So I just want to make sure that was clear that what you have is only from three individuals.
Okay, so you consider this just feedback for us that we don't need to discuss them. They will do it when it's final.
That's up to you all, but I just want to make sure that you knew that the TMC as a committee will discuss it at their next meeting with your final version, and then they would have a formal recommendation at that time.
Okay, but my understanding is that these are the CAC guiding principles, that they can provide us feedback.
Yes, they would provide feedback. I guess that's a better way to describe it. If as a committee, if they want to take any feedback back to you or the board, they will do that at their next meeting.
Okay, thank you, Farhad. Moss?
This whole inclusion of these three comments or feedback, while I think some of the content is helpful, I will say it seems out of the blue and kind of confusing to me. So I just wanted to note that. And, you know, I have like a lot of questions about why there was only three, why are they anonymous? Like, I guess I'm curious, like what was the invitation? Why were they asked to provide this feedback? Especially when we really have such an unfinished, process going on here. So, I wanted to name that on here, that this whole inclusion of those comments is, I think, actually kind of confusing. And also what I would really like to have confirmation on is that what Carolyn, I think you were getting at, that these are in fact the CAC principles or a framework, and that the TMC, we will put these forth to the board, and the board, just is like, hey, this is what we're running with, but the TNC really doesn't have say in what we are outlining, since this is under our purview.
Madam Chair, if I may, and then maybe yes. Tom can hopefully add to the response. If you recall, at the last meeting, we had this conversation. TMC obviously is working in tandem with CAC. They will provide feedback along the way. At the previous TMC meeting, Chair McGovern indicated to the TMC that we would give them an opportunity to review and comment. And that was the reason that they were provided a draft to review and comment. So this is going to be ongoing back and forth between TMC and CAC. We're going to continuously provide feedback from one committee to another committee. So don't be surprised in the future if you get feedback. That's really the intent of the process, is to have an iterative process between the two committees. So with that, Mr. Chair McGovern, if you want to add anything to that, since that was something we committed to the TMC, please do so.
Yeah, and just remind everyone that toward the end of the meeting last time, I asked if anyone really objected to sending the draft as it was, and as we had wordsmithed it in the meeting ahead of time, with the knowledge that it was still a draft, so that because of the short period of time, we could get some feedback from the TMC, and that's basically what we got, some feedback. Again, you know, they'll look at it when it's finalized, but there won't really be time at that point for us to go through another iteration. So I thought it was pretty important to give them a chance to take a look at it while we could still react to any comments that they might have or any suggestions. And for that reason, I think it's helpful for us at least to have everyone hear again, you know, today as a group, what these individual comments are. And if we want to do anything about them, great. If we want to write back to them and say, what did you mean by that? Or just simply disagree and ignore it. Those are all things available to us at that point. And I think it'd just be somewhat helpful for us to hear those comments, you know, all the feedback we can get at, you know, this late date is probably good.
Thank you, Tom. Yes, and I'll just add to that, I don't think they had a real long time. It was short turnaround time, but we wanted to see if we wanted to see if we could get any feedback. And they will be looking at it as a group at, I believe, their next TMC meeting. So that would be the time where they could have an entire committee making any suggestions. So, okay, so I've got Eva.
Yeah, I just wanted to say quickly that, you know, I agree that getting the feedback and working in tandem is important in terms of the TMC, but I also think that what I'm hearing is a concern that we might take a lot of time to wordsmith this and then have a lot of things changed or decided without our input afterwards on the tail end. And I wonder if there are any, you know, what kind of reassurances do we have in terms of the investment that we're making?
Farhad? Would you want to respond to that?
Sure, I'll be happy to. Again, as you all recognize, the board delegated that responsibility to the CAC. So this is CAC's document. You are developing a document. Obviously, any feedback you receive back from TMC, that's for your consideration and your deliberation. And as Tom just mentioned, you can do what you will with the feedback you receive. Ultimately, the board may provide some feedback as well. And same thing, hopefully, by the time it gets to the board, you've had plenty of opportunities to adopt a guiding principles that hopefully has considered all angles. So that's one of the reasons that we keep going back and forth between committees, that hopefully by the time you hear back from the board, it should be a document that is comprehensive enough that everybody would be supportive of it.
Thank you. And Moss, your hand is up.
Yeah. Thanks everyone for these thoughts. I think I guess I really misheard the conversation at the end of the call. I recalled it was like, we're going to finish these, especially since we haven't even touched the goals and such. And then the TMC would have that full time during their August meeting and have at least a week advance to review the final draft. So must have been some kind of miscommunication there as far as that. And then I also want to throw out there that while I would love for us to finalize our proposed language today, that, you know, in the spirit of collaboration across committees, there's nothing stopping us from asking the board to give the TMC a little time to review, provide feedback, and let us have that iteration so that in a more structured and clear an inclusive process for that review and collaboration than just kind of this like scrambling at the last minute to get everybody's feedback and trying to incorporate it in something. So I just want to plant the seed of, if needed, like, could we just ask the RTA board at this meeting to say, can we present these to you at the next meeting so that TMC has time to comment and in a thoughtful way, and we have time to consider and incorporate their feedback.
Okay, thank you, Moss. So I think I'm hearing that we want to go through these as we are doing, and I believe we're on number 3. So if that's okay with everyone, I will ask if there are any objections to the language in as shown in red line on guiding principle number 3. Great. Okay, moving on to number 4.
The next guiding principle, the suggestion was to add 3 areas under this one. So that reads, a future RTA plan should enhance safety and the regional transportation system overall efficiency to 1, address equity, mobility, accessibility, economic vitality; 2, mitigate impacts of climate change; and then 3, the region's environmental sustainability and resilience.
Thank you. First, Abby, I've got Patricia, and then Eva.
Yeah, thank you. So at the close of our last meeting, I was instructed to send over a specific statement that I had proposed regarding the climate change bullet point. I believe that we sort of decided as a group that it would be better in its own bullet point. I sent that over and I thought that it would be included in the revision document for everyone to review and be ready to discuss. This is not the statement that I sent over, so I was just surprised and curious as to how this statement was put together, and also if there's any room to consider my original statement that you had requested that I send over.
Okay, well, let me ask Paki the answer to that, and also if you received any other suggestions via email that I assume they're not here on what we're looking at. Did you get anything else, and could you address Patricia's question?
What we did was reiterate what was said at the meeting, and then any additional information I received via email was incorporated into that.
Okay.
Madam Chair, if I may add to that as well. So if you recall, as part of the meeting process, and obviously Chair McGovern was doing a good job of confirming with everyone if they agreed with the approach. So this appeared to be the consensus, obviously with everybody's consensus today, that appeared to be where you landed at the last meeting. So that's why you have what you have in front of you.
Okay. Eva, and then Abby.
Yes, I was also instructed to draft some new language for an equity bullet, and I have that language. We can go over that after this one, but I just wanted to mention it because this one says address equity. We would presumably replace that with the bullet that I crafted, if that's what we decide to do.
Okay, I think that'd be a good idea to bring everything, bring all that into the conversation. And well, let's see, we'll get the more comments from people. First, Abby, and then Tom.
Yeah, I think I'm probably just repeating a lot of what was said, but this bullet to me looks like at least four things. It doesn't make sense to have it enhancing safety and efficiency to do other things. Number one looks like it's probably four different things. Number two, I would love to see Patricia's language. And then number three, I think, well, there needs to be a verb there. But I think this is four bullet points, and I think it's, I also remember that people were invited to write more lengthier definitions that were clearer, because at the last meeting, I think we were mostly in agreement about the kinds of changes that needed to be made. We were just having a hard time wordsmithing on the go. So I'm very frustrated that we're not seeing any of that language that people worked on really carefully between then and now. And I think we need to see that. And I also just want to loop in again that I think that that's the kind of stuff that we need to be getting emailed to all of us in between the meeting. It's not a violation of the open meeting laws. It's an efficient use of our time. We make the decisions at the meetings. That's why it's not a violation of open meeting laws, but we have a chance to look at things not on the go. So I think this bullet point needs to be addressed, and I want to see what, I don't know how many people submitted comments. I don't think we've heard that. And I think we need to see everybody's, because there's a lot of very smart people involved here.
Thank you. Tom?
Yeah, I just want to point out one thing on item number three. There were some good suggestions from the TMC member to make those action words at the beginning, but we left out enhance the region's environmental sustainability and resilience. So the word enhance, I think, needs to go in there for this to make any sense. But I wonder if Patricia could read, or was it Patricia, the, or was it Eva that, that emailed the definition that we, you know, the different wording, so that we could at least hear it right now.
Yes, Patricia, could you provide that for us?
Sure, yeah, thank you. And I look forward to hearing other folks' comments, but part of it I think was that I wanted it to be its own specific bullet point and not try to accomplish too much in this one. But I had written in, must address the impacts of climate change and enhance the region's environmental sustainability and resilience, as well as improve quality of air, water, and wildlife habitat.
As one bullet.
Correct.
Thank you. So which part of this bullet, take climate change out and the rest stay the same? Or maybe this is a discussion we all need to have.
Carolyn, if I may jump in.
Yes, Moss.
Thank you. As I recall the conversation from the last meeting where we landed, and I think Abby was getting at this point, just to reiterate though, we decided that this fourth bullet was doing a lot of heavy lifting and that we needed to break it apart in order to adequately address, and not like break it apart within it. I think it was like a remove bullet point number four and add in these other things as separate new, you know, self-standing bullets was my understanding from that conversation. And so I just hope that that provides some clarity and that this was not what we discussed in the last meeting, this iteration. And so Patricia's comment could replace this need for anything in the environmental sustainability and resiliency section.
Okay, thank you. And Rachel.
Yes, hi. I just wanted to second what Maz is saying is this isn't what we agreed to. We agreed to create new language to put in and break out separate bullet points. Just wanted to reiterate that.
Okay, thank you. And then Eva, and then I'm going to suggest a way maybe we can get through this. Eva.
So I'd like to share the language that I was asked to create. This would be another bullet. I'd like to at least read it so people can have it in mind as we go about this. Again, I was hoping that we would be looking at a document that was a working document so we could actually put this in front of everybody today instead of me just reading it, because I know it can be hard to follow and we don't have chat box functionality either, but I'll just read it. This would be a separate bullet. Should prioritize equitable services and equitable growth by making investments in historically underserved and disinvested areas and populations with a special focus on repair for communities facing undue burden and harm.
Great. I didn't write all of that down. Can you say it one more time?
Yes, ma'am. Should prioritize equitable services and equitable growth by making investments in historically underserved and disinvested areas and populations with a special focus on repair for communities facing undue burden and harm. So what this refers to, just for the record, is that motor vehicle fatalities disproportionately affect minority populations, right? The pedestrian fatality rate for Latinos is 60% higher than the rate for whites, and for African Americans is almost 75% higher than the rate for whites nationally.
Okay, thank you. Karen?
Three things. I want to also repeat that it would be really nice to have the chat if we could get that going. I'd like to hear Patricia Schwartz, if we have time. I'd like to hear that again. I thought we had the term livability in there, and I really would like to see that returned. Thanks.
Thank you. This is what I'm going to suggest. Let's just go through this, get the new language, discuss having, this might turn into 4 or 5 or 6 bullets. So if we could start with just the should enhance safety and the regional transportation system's overall efficiency. Do people feel that that is one bullet? Yes, any discussion on that? Okay, so that's guiding principle number 4. And then number 1, with the addressing equity. Now, Eva, I assume that bullet, the language you just read, which I believe Paki has.
I didn't email it because I wasn't prompted to email it. So I just had it ready for today's meeting.
Okay. And are you suggesting that would be a new bullet?
Yes. We would take out equity from here, from what we're looking at, and it would be a totally new bullet.
Okay, and that would not include mobility, accessibility, economic vitality. It would just be a bullet to address equity.
I mean, I'm not necessarily opposed to including mobility, accessibility, and economic vitality here, but I think that equity should have its own bullet.
Okay. Is there any discussion on that? Does anybody have a problem with that or have changes? Yes.
Madam Chair, this is Justine. I'm sorry. I'm wondering if there is a way that somebody can actually write this live. I know we don't have the chat feature enabled, but maybe on just a Word document and share that screen so that we can kind of look at the words. I did not write it down. I'm sorry. I'm not in. If that is a possibility at all, I think just to have a kind of a living, moving document, it's very hard to follow all of these suggestions and changes.
I would ask the staff, is that possible? We have a couple of long bullets that people don't have in front of them. Is there any way to get them up on a screen? While we're working that out,
I defer to senior staff on this. At the last meeting, I was planning to do that, but I was told that we needed to focus on the slides. Excuse me. So I don't know at this point. I'm so sorry. I right now I can try and do it, but I just want to make sure with our senior staff.
It's just a technology challenge there. So I think Crystal could answer the question. If someone has it written somewhere, can they share their screen?
Yeah, but Farhad and Mary is talking to Crystal right now. And so hopefully.
Yeah, as long as it's typed somewhere, then I think if they can share their screen, that's what you're looking for, right?
Right.
I thought they wanted us to edit. So if someone can share their screen, that would be easier.
Yeah. So as long as it's already written somewhere.
Okay. Eva, can you share Eva share her screen first?
Yes. So I've allowed sharing if someone has it written down and would like to share their Word document.
Yeah, I can pull that up. Give me one second.
Thank you. And there's a couple more comments that I'm going to take here while you're doing that. One from Rachel and one from Chris Schmaltz.
Thank you. Sorry if this is out of line, but I just wanted to point out how hard we worked last time to try and make today's meeting possible and productive, and the tools we asked for are just not here even. Sorry, just wanted to point that out.
Yeah, thank you. I think we're all a little bit frustrated about that. Chris?
Thank you, Madam Chair. As it relates to the guiding principle sort of number, what would be a new five, I agree and feel strongly that one that addresses equity is important. This statement that's on the screen right now that hopefully everybody sees needs to be simplified. In my opinion, these are guiding principles of ours to apply to the projects that we need to evaluate for purposes of formulating RTA next. And so by definition, as guiding principles, they're not going to address every circumstance, but they are the prism through which we evaluate the projects that we have before us. So I feel strongly wordsmithing by committee is always rough, but if we sort of remember that the overall point of this document is guiding principles, then hopefully we can approach an individual bullet that I totally support should be simplified in a way that speaks to the definition of equity in this context. So that would be my overarching point.
Thank you. Moss?
Well, one, Chris, I'm curious to see if you have any specific examples of what you would want, what you think needs simplified on this bullet, because yeah.
I would, Moss, I would end the bullet at disinvested areas.
Okay. Well, and what's your reasoning for ending it from there?
Because it's simple and it addresses exactly the point that I think it's trying to make with regard to equity, in that there have been investments in areas that have been underserved and disinvested. That's what we need to say.
I'm curious, Eva, since you proposed it, is there anything specific that you think is in that last clause that isn't covered in the first statement?
I think that we could end the sentence right here after populations because there are areas, regions specifically, geographically, that have been disinvested, but also we have certain demographics, right, that have been disinvested, and they are not specific to areas. So I personally could cut this and think that it still keeps the equity lens intact because it still says historically underserved and disinvested. And that makes reference to the undue burden and harm, right? It's all still in the package. If we do this edit, I would be okay with that.
Anybody else? So is everyone okay? This would be a new bullet after the safety, the equity bullet. Is everyone okay with this language as you see it on the screen, as small as it is? Okay. Well, let's move on. That's our bullet number 5, I think. Okay.
We got 3. What is 4?
Okay, now. Yes, and so now I think Patricia, would you like to read your climate change bullet again, please?
Sure.
Whoever's sharing should stop sharing.
Okay. Oh, maybe you can share.
Can Ava just write it as I say?
I can write it as you type it. That's fine. I'll do it.
Thank you. I had must address the impacts of climate change and enhance the region's environmental sustainability and resilience. Sorry, did I lose you?
Can you go back?
Sorry. I wasn't watching you type in the notes.
Okay, go back.
Okay, and enhance the region's environmental sustainability and resilience, as well as improve quality of air, water, and wildlife habitat. Thank you.
Thank you. Any discussion on this new proposed bullet? Karen.
I don't quite know how to say this, but maybe it's already covered in here. I want to make sure that if we have a choice between green and concrete, that we choose green. And if we're making improvements to an area, or, you know, a project is supposedly making improvements, that we're not ever choosing to cover up green. So do you think that's covered in here already, or does that need to, do we need to specifically say choose green over concrete?
Can I just say that I think that would go under the livability bullet?
But livability has been taken out, hasn't it?
I thought we were going to do a whole new livability bullet that was going to be unpacked a little bit so that it wasn't going to be less squishy.
I have some language that I drafted to get at that, get at the livability piece. So I just wanted to throw that out there, but don't want to derail us completely. Sorry. I like your comment too, Karen. Thank you.
Do you want to just give it to me so we can have it on screen?
Sure. So what I drafted was must promote a vibrant regional economy and resilient, livable communities while connecting underserved and transportation disadvantaged areas.
Thank you, Moss. So these are three separate ones. Seems that there's some overlap and we might be able to shorten some of those as I see it, but let me get, I thought I saw Chris's. Anybody else on this? Yes, Diane.
Madam Chair, did we ever decide if we wanted to make our language consistent with should or must, because they're alternating?
Right, I think we had, yeah, but we've got both throughout.
Madam Chair, if I may respond to that. Yes. So as Chair McGovern mentioned earlier, at the last meeting, we discussed that. And the consensus that we have is that anything that is required by law should have must. And if it's just an advisory recommendation, that could be should.
Thank you. Yes, I recall that.
I was just going to mention, similar to what Chris had on the previous bullet, I think this one could probably be shortened after sustainability and resilience. Improve air, quality of air is actual goal. And then we also discussed wildlife-related crashes down in the goals area as well. We don't have any discussion of water, however.
Okay, so the suggestion is to edit this bullet. Must address the impacts of climate change and enhance the region's environmental sustainability.
And resilience.
And resilience.
And I think it should be a should.
And it should be a should. because it's not the law, I don't think.
I agree.
Patricia? Well, we've got Chris, let me ask Chris to say something first, and then we'll ask Patricia about those changes.
I agree with, thank you, Madam Chair. I agree with that edit to the second new bullet, should address the impacts of climate change. And just as, and I was just reacting to the comment with regard to choosing between concrete and green. This is a transportation plan. If it's a parks plan, I think that's correct. The comment's correct. I'm with you on sort of all of these principles and ideas in terms of guiding principles, but it's a transportation plan. It's not going to do all of that. And most of what we're choosing between is concrete or asphalt. And getting, hopefully, the regional plan will get people out of their in single-use cars, but also we have to address the realities of the single-use car and people going to work and things like that. So I'm with you on the concrete versus green, but also I like this statement because it says what's within the purview of the regional transportation plan, which is environmental sustainability and resilience. And we need to address sort of people driving around by themselves in their car. I'm wholly in support of all of those ideas. So I like the change because I think buried in the environmental sustainability and resilience is improving air. And I'm not sure how we impact water, but water and wildlife habitat. So I think that's a good change.
Okay, Patricia.
Thanks. I don't know that the abridged version gets to all the points that I was trying to encompass here. For one, I wanted to include wildlife habitat, which does not actually have to do with wildlife crashes in particular, but more about preserving natural ecosystems. And as was mentioned, we don't address water here. I think just due to the inordinate impact of transportation, really at the front lines of climate change, I think we do have a duty to consider, you know, in a little bit more granularity, the different impacts that are possible. And then I guess I'm not super clear on the must versus should distinction. Are we just going with what is the law? Because I think, I mean, we do have, you know, standards around air quality and other things like that that we could point to if we're using the law specifically to determine what is a must. But also, ultimately, I think these are our principles, and I guess I'm just not sure what the distinction there.
Yeah, from what Farhad just explained, is that must is in the law in terms of the regional transportation plan statutes and what we must have. So that's not what we talked about last time. Let me see, there's another, let me go with Abby.
Sorry, lawyer. 485309 is the statute. It says shall. Shall's the word. It's shall or may.
Okay.
Not must. So that's where we have the shall include a public transportation component and then may, among other things. So those are the two languages in there. But I agree with whoever just spoke. These are our internal guiding principles. I don't think that may, must, well, I think may versus shall is important, but I think that shall and must mean hopefully the same thing to us. But yeah.
Thank you. Let's see, who do we have? Moss and then Tom.
Can I virtually put my hand up? Because I'm screen sharing, I can't put my hand up. It's Ava.
Noted. Oh.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, thanks, Abby, for bringing that up. I am curious then, it's kind of that clarification of, because I think there are things like, well, they apps, I don't know. Maybe it's like a thing that we're focusing on that's unnecessary, but I am curious to hear other folks. I saw Tom pop on, but he might have some wisdom. The one plug I did want to make to Patricia's point about the air quality, improve air quality, water and wild life habitat, is that, you know, even in our map, greenhouse gas emissions is a, reducing greenhouse gas emissions is a goal, I believe. And so I think like improving air quality and water and all those things relate to greenhouse gas emissions, and reducing it are contributing factors, right? Like water and greenhouse, water energy nexus and reducing the consumption of what it means to distribute, generate energy and all those other things are related to our water and can have greenhouse gas emission implications. So I think it's relevant given PAG's planning documents and such, and could just help to explicitly state what's the great realm of everything that's included in this framework and how we're looking at this these projects.
Thank you. And I do want to remind everyone that we do also have the goals. So keep that in mind as we're looking at the guiding principle language and the goal language, and hope you're thinking about that, because that might be a place to put some of these items. Tom.
Yeah, that was my point, at least one of them, that we can certainly, and I support shortening this one just as was described after resilience, because the actual goal is what that last clause is getting at, the goal of improving the quality of the air, water, and wildlife habitat. And I think those should be down in the bottom. As far as should and shall, remember everything here starts with the statement that a future RTA plan, either should, must, or whatever, you know, and then describes what our individual guidelines will be. So if we want to say that a future RTA plan, as far as we're concerned, should address or must address, then I can understand it. We had adopted this method of deciding between must and shall, or must and should, but it is our document. If we have to change it, if we want to change it, we can. But also remember that most of this stuff is going to be brought into focus when we develop a tool for deciding kind of the weight of these individual guidelines. As Chris said earlier, we're not going to meet all of these guidelines or even, you know, half the goals on an individual project or an individual categorical, but taken as a whole, the entire plan itself needs to be complete enough that it addresses all of these issues in one form or another. And I think that's really the point here. Let's do the best we can to get our intent here, and then let's work with a tool that allows us to say which is the most important. I've heard some people say that the most important thing is going to be transit. Others say the most important thing is going to be, you know, access to, you know, economic vitality. And I think all of us will have somewhat different ideas about what those weights are. And let's get these things down so that we can start that work.
Thank you, Tom. Okay, so are we ready to make a decision about this language in the guiding principles, shall, should, or must, and where it ends? We have two different proposals. One is to stop at resilience, and one is to keep the whole sentence in. Patricia, are you still wanting to keep that entire sentence as is, or would you be willing to shorten it to resilience, and then we can achieve this in other ways, as in through the tool and through the goals, the language at the end?
Sure. I think my main concern was just laying out some more specifics. I think sustainability and resilience are broad terms that can be interpreted 50 million different ways. If the committee would rather shorten it here and work on this in the goals, doing more specific outlining there, I could welcome that suggestion, but just want to make a note that we do move forward with considering that whenever we get to the goals.
Okay, thank you. So are there any objections to this bullet saying, should address the impacts of climate change and enhance the region's environmental sustainability and resilience? Abby?
So I think it should be shall. I think that's the more powerful one here, and that is the statutory language. Right. And I agree with Patricia's concerns, and I come at this from a place where the word sustainability is used sometimes to mean like economic sustainability in a non-environmental sense, and sometimes environmental. And so I think that having the improved quality of air, water, and wildlife habitat as a broad statement is really important, so we understand what that means. I do think that's going to need to be defined more. But I think for the guiding principles that need to remain. And I think I'm continuing to hear consensus from the CAC on what we think should be in this. And I have already expressed my frustration. This feels like a waste of time because I think we're all on board with this. And I think that the more specific the language is, the better we are right now. So I would like to make that be shall, and I would like to keep that last clause in there.
Okay, does anyone have a problem with shall? No objections. Okay, and we're not really voting on these now, so I'm wondering if we want to have a motion for one and or the other. As a placeholder, until we vote on the whole guiding principle document, hopefully when we're done today. I will ask how many are in favor of the shortened version, shall address the impacts of climate change and enhance the region's environmental sustainability and resilience.
Madam Chair, this is Chris.
Yes.
I would caution against any motions associated with any individual components. We'll be here for a week. My suggestion is that you keep to what you had been doing, which is objections related to language, so we continue to move on through the rest of the document, and then have a single motion that addresses the entire document.
Thank you, Chris. Okay, so there's one objection so far to keeping it, ending at resilience. Are there any other objections to that? Yes, Diane?
Objection. Not an objection, just a comment.
Okay, I think we'll move forward with that and hopefully address this in a later fashion. Then there's one more.
Oh, can I just make a comment real quick?
Yes, Eva.
So I think that we, one of the questions about how specific we need to be here is there a possibility that these priorities would be read separately from the goals? As long as we can ensure that it's one document that's never divvied up, right, then we have those clarifying points that are going to be baked in into the goals section. But if there's any possibility that somebody might take these priorities and read them separately from the goals, then we know that there's actually more possibility for, you know, a lack of clarity. And I, you know, even the conversation that we're having really illustrates that not everybody sees how air quality or water quality are related to transit and transportation projects, when actually, you know, water runoff is a really big part of road building and how that affects, you know, water quality as it goes into, you know, the aquifer. So, I mean, I think that it's not always clear, and any level of clarity that we can provide is going to be a good thing. And whether we do that through the goals or through the priorities as they're expressed, I think is fine. But, you know, we just have to be cognizant of how this document is going to be used, published, and read.
Thank you. Paki or Farha, can you confirm that this is one package as it is given to the board, the public, et cetera?
Sure. As you recall, it has been presented as one document adopted by the CAC, so any changes will be treated the same way.
Thank you.
Yeah, and just recall that we call this the two things together, the guidelines and the goals, as our regional framework. So yes, it is one document. We can call it our framework for simplicity, but all of these have to work together.
Thank you, Tom. I have a couple of hands. I'm not sure if they're still up. Chris, yes. Did you have another comment?
I do. It's related to the purpose of this document. Just a reminder, all of us, that this is our document. What this is intended to produce is the plan, which is what the public will comment on, review, and ultimately vote on. So this is intended to produce the projects and the language of the plan that we take to the voters. So we're wordsmithing and talking about the details of this document, which is intended to guide all of us individually with regard to how we vote on individual projects and the construction of the plan itself. So getting consensus is more achievable if the language of the guiding principles is broader, because everybody might have a different view on what a region's environmental sustainability and resilience means. And they look at a project and view that project through the filter of how they view improving the quality of air, water, wildlife habitat, if it's in the document or not. I agree that improving quality of air, water, and wildlife habitat should be a goal. But as a guiding principles document, the more general it can be while also providing for here are our priorities is the way we should be going, in my opinion, because we will get through this project process, get a document everybody's comfortable with in terms of the committee, and then we can actually get to the work of reviewing and evaluating projects to include in the plan.
Thank you, Chris. And yes, I think this exercise, as painful as it is to do editing in a group setting, I think the committee really has an interest in knowing that we all agree on these guiding principles. And so I think it's worth the effort. So hopefully we can keep moving. And I think I saw Rachel's hand up.
Thank you. Yes, I just wanted to say that, Chris, I disagree, actually, that I believe that narrowing is important because once we can agree, if we have disagreements, we should vet those right now so that we can talk about our core beliefs about what transportation can and should be. And so I'm all in favor of this going through this painful process. And I wanted to say that I appreciate Carolyn's attention to detail in reviewing and asking for motions on the document as we create it. I like that approach. And I disagree with you, Chris, about doing an up or down vote just on the entire document. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. Okay, I think we're done with this, the climate change bullet. And the next one is where I think there is a little bit of redundancy that we might be able to deal with, but I'll ask for comments on this. The last bullet that's up on the screen anyway is must promote a vibrant regional economy and resilient livable communities while connecting underserved and transportation disadvantaged areas. So are there any comments on that bullet? Support, changes, opposition? Anybody have any comments on that?
Madam Chair, this is Chris. I think we're missing the word population. I think we wanted to include that, right? Or that's in the first bullet, sorry.
Yes.
Yeah, that was going to be my main comment. I feel like we have a lot of this bullet elsewhere. We talk about, so just, I guess, just to backtrack a little bit, I think we need to go back to bullet 4 and somehow incorporate the number 1 minus the equity statement, because that's a separate bullet now. But anyhow, so I think we do need to go back and do that because we did talk about the economic vitality in that. Resilience is in the second bullet now. The second bullet on the screen.
Uh-huh.
And then we're missing livable communities. And then underserved and transportation disadvantaged areas, I think, is now covered under the first bullet on this screen. So my suggestion, if you want to go back to bullet number 4 of the original document, should enhance safety. And
okay.
So my suggestion would be you should enhance safety and the regional transportation system's overall ability to address mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic vitality. Then that covers the first item 1 under that original bullet.
Okay, so I think you said should enhance safety and the regional transportation's overall ability to address mobility, accessibility, and economic vitality?
I added in livability.
And livability somewhere.
Could you go over it again for me?
Could you say it one more time, please?
Should enhance safety and the regional transportation system's overall ability to address mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic vitality.
Okay, slow down, Tiger. One more time.
Okay. Oh, sorry.
Okay,
I'll go slower.
Well, wait, let me just say, does everyone understand that he went back to our safety bullet that before, at the beginning of this meeting with the red changes, should enhance safety in the regional transportation system's overall efficiency too, and then we had the 3 sub bullets. So this is a different, these are all their own bullets now, and he is going back to that first one and adding and combining a little bit, merging it, yes, with sub bullet 1. So I don't know if that made it more confusing or less, but one more time.
Should enhance safety and the regional transportation system's overall, I changed efficiency to ability. My word. To address mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic vitality.
Thank you. And that would replace or would change the original first one and replace, we would delete that last new bullet, correct?
The vibrant. Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. Okay, any Domas, any discussion?
I think I'm generally okay with that. I guess I did like, I do think that like the one thing I've seen in a lot of plans, even in our regional, in our region, is this like term of vibrant economy and resilience. So I would be like, I'm sorry, I don't know who was speaking in the room, but I would be curious to see if we can meld some of the language a little bit more, because they are used, those are terms that are used in kind of other plans to say specific things about vibrancy, which can include not only economic like production, like about the productive economy, but also like cultural vibrancy and culture, like an economy that reflects that cultural component. So that's why there's some of these terms get used. And so I'm curious to try to smash these a little together, you know, also thanks Ava for doing this work live on screen.
So are you suggesting that in the last part of that, it says vibrant regional economy instead of economic vitality?
I'm trying to think on the fly a little bit of how to make sure that what I was trying to achieve with that last bullet, it gets blended in with the new proposed one. So I don't know. I just need a minute to do that.
Okay. And what's on the screen now is economic and cultural vibrancy. Okay, Tom?
Just want to say that I support what Kevin suggested. I think it's great. I think those other items fit very well into the intent of that now fourth bullet, which, you know, was the fourth bullet. We've started breaking it down. I'm good with it. If you want to add an adjective to mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic vitality, okay, but I'd kind of like to hear what those suggestions are, just because it starts to get very wordy, and I think the wordier it is, the more difficult it is for us to support it as we're evaluating projects.
Okay, Eva, are you doing is that you doing the editing on the screen?
Yep, that's me.
Okay, thank you, just checking. Okay, so here's what we have on the screen, and I know Moss is, your minute is almost up. Should enhance safety and the regional transportation system's overall ability to address mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic and cultural vibrancy. So let's see, Tom, is your hand supposed to still be up? Chris, you have a statement?
Yeah, I do. Words moving on the fly. Maybe we change the word address to improve. I think that might get to the point that's been made. We don't simply want to address it. We want to improve it. And then we don't have to change vitality. We can leave vitality in. I like the end cultural, and then take out vibrancy. So improve mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic and cultural vitality.
I think that works for me. Thanks, Chris.
Wow, great. Okay, so who said it was?
So are we going back to vitality?
Yes, I'll read it.
That was my suggestion, yeah.
I'll read this one more time and then see if we've got something akin to consensus. Okay, should enhance safety and the regional transportation system's overall ability to improve mobility, accessibility, livability, and economic and cultural vitality. Are there any objections to that language? Okay, we're almost to the end of the goals. Yeah, well, we're almost to the goals. Okay, so there is, let's go back to Pocky. Pocky, are you still there?
Pocky's still there.
I'm here.
Okay, so we've just made that one bullet and sub-bullets into 1, 2, 3 new bullets. So the next one, can you move on to the next one that we didn't have any changes last time, I don't believe.
Yeah, if you stop sharing, oh, there you go.
Oh, yes, thanks, Eva.
Just trying to move it here. All right, the fifth guiding principle that you originally had, which had no revisions, was that a future RTA plan should consider future land use, travel patterns, mode choices, and technological advances.
Okay, so I'm assuming I shouldn't assume anything, but there were no changes to this last time. Can we all, are there any objections to this bullet or revisions? Okay, moving on to the last one, which I believe was a new one.
That's correct.
Okay.
This was the sixth guiding principle that was added, which is a future RTA plan should include a process to reasonably respond to changing circumstances and conditions over the life of the plan.
Thank you. Dale?
I think there was one of the responses from the board about the rules and the law that I regarded that significantly impacts this. I'm not sure how we respond to that, but I wanted to point that out that there's some very specific language in the law that limits what can be changed after the fact without requiring another election. And I'm not sure I'm an expert enough on that, or that I remember enough of that at this point to discuss it much. So maybe Farhad can address that. But that the ability to modify is limited by that. I think we need to understand that to write this.
Okay, yes, thank you.
Madam Chair, I'd be happy to
add
to that. Yeah, thank you, Dale. If you recall, we've been having this discussion off and on, even at the board level, they have had the discussion about what level of flexibility can be built into the plan. So as you mentioned, there are very strict guidelines within the current RTA statutes that allows certain changes, but I think that would be a policy decision that the board needs to determine at some point how they would move forward with any potential modifications. So my recommendation, and I recall this one was from Bruce, my recommendation is that this is probably not going to add any value in what you're doing. It's more of a policy discussion that the board will have throughout the process, and hopefully give you some feedback on it later on.
Thank you, Farhad. Okay, I have Moss and then Abby.
Thanks, Carolyn. So actually looking at page 8 in the meeting packet, they talk about, staff provided some context or response to this sort of thing. And specifically it notes that the statutes require for named corridor projects to include a scope, start date, and budget. And that later on, they also talk about the clarity about the flexibility to modify the plan after voter approval, in which they say the board has authority to make certain adjustments. However, the modifications to the projects, specifically to the projects, is what's stipulated as being having to have voter approval. So when I was reading this, and why I think this is so important for us to keep in here, given all the discussions we've had about first, like First Avenue is one example of projects getting delayed and maybe getting rolled over, and, you know, just the inflation issue, project projection. So scoping, like all the issues with Broadway, you know, and how projections just didn't map out. What I think this is really important to keep in and is probably going to come into play when we're thinking about how many named projects we want to include in our proposed plan to the board. Because if we have categorical elements as the focus where a budget's going there, then that does have flexibility built into it and might, what it sounds like, that might be might be what our region has been needing and needs to do so that we're not running building projects that don't really meet our regional needs any longer. So, you know, I think that's worthwhile to consider. And I think that we do need to have something in our framework that talks about flexibility because we don't want to get burned again.
Thank you, Moss. Abby?
Yeah, so looking at the statute on that, but also following up on, I think, Moss's intent and something that Diane said at another meeting, we've been told repeatedly that we're accountable to 2006 voters. And I think that having language in our guiding principles saying that we're responsive to change. And I would also add changing circumstances and conditions as well as new information and knowledge, because I think that that's another thing that prompts change. But I'm looking at the actual statute and it has to go back to the voters if a substantial change occurs. And then there's a definition of substantial change, and it's really basically monetary if things cost more. So if we're looking at a plan and based on changing demographics, new knowledge about road safety, whatever else, we decide that we can do something that's going to be cheaper, that serves our current needs and goals better, that doesn't need to go back to the voters. So I want the legal stuff to be less mysterious to people. I know that I'm not the RTA's lawyer, but we have yet to see the RTA's lawyer. So I'm just gonna keep the statutes up and keep saying that every time this comes up. So I like this language, I think it's great. And I do wanna add new knowledge or information to it.
Okay, I've got Rachel, a comment.
Hi, yes. Thank you, Abby, for bringing that clarifying language in from the statute. I agree wholeheartedly that we not only do we need this guiding principle, but we do need to change it. We do need to add that change you suggested about increasing knowledge, because as we've seen, research should impact decisions we make. And as long as it's not creating a financial increase, then it doesn't have to go to the voters, but we should be flexible enough to deal with it. So thank you, Moss, and thank you, Abby.
Okay, so let me get that. I don't know if we need to share the screen with the changes or not, but I just want to say I agree. I mean, it will be up to the board on as to how, you know, they're going to be dealing with this flexibility issue themselves, but there's no reason for it not for us not to have that as one of our principles. But Abby, could you repeat this bullet with your changes?
Sure. Should include a process to reasonably respond to changing circumstances and conditions, as well as new knowledge and information over the life of the plan. And I apologize because I was chewing.
We couldn't.
This brownie's really good.
Okay, I've got Chris and then Rachel, and then hopefully we can come to a
forget me.
Oh, is Tom? Oh, hi, Tom. Yes.
Quickly, they forget.
Tom who?
Yeah, Tom who? Yeah, I'm just going to throw a monkey wrench in. I don't agree with this being in our framework. What I think it should be is a joint memo or report from the CAC and the TMC to the board, making suggestions about how this, you know, flexibility and resiliency could be built into the plan. We're not going to be able to build that resiliency in just by what we do. I think it's sort of saying, well, let's just don't put anything in the named projects, and then everything will be, up for grabs. But I don't think that's overstating it, obviously. But I don't think that's a great approach either, because the people really who want to vote for this project or for this program need to know as much detail as possible about the projects themselves. And so there's a balancing act there. The board is going to have to decide if this is something that is so important that they even need to go back to the legislature to try to get the wording changed to give them more ability to make those kind of changes when new circumstances present themselves. But as far as for us putting a plan together, I just don't see it. I think it's very important that we tell them what we think about it, that we tell the board what we think about it and how important it is that it be built into the program. But I'm not feeling this one.
Dale?
I have to agree with Tom. I don't see how this is really an element of the plan. I really like the idea of a separate memo. Ultimately, it is the board's and the legislature's decision as to how they modify it. And obviously, probably it comes to the legislature matter what board puts in it, but as whether they'll buy the change. But I think we do, as having been through the Broadway process and the arguments and the discussions at that time, this is a topic that really needs to be dealt with. And I think Tom's all right that the best way to deal with it is a memo to the board with our feelings about what flexibility and how it should be in there. And then they can move forward from there.
Okay, so I think what I've heard from you and Tom and perhaps Farhad is that this isn't something that belongs in the plan, because the plan will have the projects and the process is something, and any kind of flexibility is something that's an adjunct that we should ask the board to adopt. And it sounds like from what the TMC, some of the comments in the TMC, it sounds like they agree with that too. Does anyone object to that, to feel strongly enough that this needs to be in the guiding principles?
Madam Chair, this is Chris.
Yes, Chris.
Yeah, I object to leaving it out. I support Rachel's comments and Abby's language, because remember, this is language in our guiding principles. The plan has to comply with the statute, and the wrangling over how much flexibility is in the plan that goes to the voters will ultimately be determined by the board. But as a guiding principle statement, with regard to, we need to be considering what we've learned over the past RTA original as a guiding principle, I feel strongly that this should be in there. It's a should statement, not a must. It's a should statement.
Thank you. Rachel?
Yes, thank you. I agree with especially at the end of what Chris said. These are our guiding principles. And I think it's okay for us to have guiding principles that are possibly different from what the board's interpretation is, because we as voters, as citizens, that's our whole purpose on the CAC, is to express citizen input. And what we're saying is we want the plan to include a process for reasonably responding to change. And so I feel very strongly that this should be in our guiding principles and not just a memo to the board.
Okay, I don't know if I'm hearing consensus really. Would anybody object to this staying in as restated by Abby and also writing a memo to the board to emphasize that?
Wait, can you restate what we're objecting? What
the question? Let's just that last part. Just objecting to the language that says should include a process to reasonably respond to changing circumstances and conditions, as well as new knowledge and information. Is that it? Over the life of the plan. Does anybody object to keeping that in?
Yeah, I do. Okay. I don't see how this can help us develop a plan. I think the plan has to have that. I totally agree. But it's not giving us guidelines to developing the plan that we're going to develop.
Okay, so Ron and Dale and Tom and Chuck are a disagreement. So now what?
So how many are in agreement?
How many are in agreement? Raise your hands.
Agreement with what?
The language.
Saying it.
Saying, okay. Keeping that in there.
Raise your hands.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Okay. We'll leave that in there for now. And that was the end of the guiding principles. Unless there are any new guiding principles that people have in mind that we haven't talked about yet. Okay, I'll take that as a no. So the goals.
Sorry, real quick, because I think it kind of got addressed in other places, but I did want to state it, was something I wordsmithed that I think, I'll just read it. So it was must develop a safe, efficient, reliable, well-maintained and connected transportation system that is accessible to all residents by providing quality infrastructure services that meet the needs of residents and modes by leveraging demand management strategies and intelligent transportation systems. So I'm sure there are ways to trim that down. And I think it also is kind of captured in certain other, I think the spirit of this is captured in other bits. The things I don't know that are quite captured, maybe it's something for the goals. I'm curious what other perspectives, what other folks' ideas they have, but specifically the leveraging demand management strategies and intelligent transportation systems. I know that I've heard at least Bruce come up, say a lot of times about like thinking about technology and everything that will just like help us move better through our system. And I kind of see where maybe that's getting addressed, but I don't know. I feel strongly that these demand management and intelligence systems like that should be key parts of this plan, whether it's the framework or if that's a goal. So trying to help us move on, but also wanted to put those ideas out there.
I guess I would ask, were those some of those ideas something that we can build on in the goals? Because it does sound like we've addressed a lot of those, but I didn't write all that down, so I'm not sure that you agree.
That's where I'm teetering, so maybe it's okay. I wanted to get people's wheels turning.
Okay, yeah, thank you. I understand, and I'm it's too bad that Bruce isn't here because he has been talking about that for a while. So I'd like to just move on to the goals. And just a time check, it's I think 20 minutes of. So let's see if we can get through these goals. And Pocky, are you doing that too?
So these are the first five goals out of the 10. The suggested decisions are in red. So the first five were reduce congestion, provide efficient mobility, and your residents had asked to include across the region, improve transit ridership, and then reduce crashes was changed, and then reduce wildlife-related crashes.
Okay, before you do, I did have something to add to the last bullet that's been bothering me, and it's mostly because it more actively reflects what the goal of that category is or subcategory. I wanted to add to that one and say, reduce wildlife-related crashes and provide for wildlife connectivity across the landscape. There are better ways to say that, but it's wordier. So that was my suggestion. Dale?
Okay. Number one, I like your proposed change there.
Thank you.
Five. And I was just going to propose on item three, it says reduce crashes. And I was going to say between vehicles, bikes, and pedestrians to indicate that it's just not, it's crashes of all kinds. And obviously without, if you had, you know, we could also say wildlife in there, but you're dealing with that in a separate.
Okay, thank you. And I'm just wondering if anybody can be typing this up on a shared screen like we did before. Would that be possible? One of the remote participants? Possible. Okay. Yes, Diane. Chair,
I wanted to point out one of the TMC suggestions was change the word reduce crashes to reduce particular accidents. Would that cover all the data?
I think this is a goal, and I, you know, yes, I think you're probably right, but I think it's more clear when you list them all. Okay. And, you know, there is a presumption by some people that it's all about vehicles. And I want to get away from the idea that because we have a tremendous problem in the community with pedestrians and bicycles. And I think it needs to be clear that that's a goal to reduce.
Thank you, Kevin.
The one issue I had with the suggestion from the TMC, I guess, is it says traffic related accidents or something. And accidents generally implies that there's nobody at fault. Whereas crashes, you know, there's nothing we can do about an accident, right? So the wording crashes, I think, is appropriate. I would say reduce crashes across all modes, but we can, I'm fine with Dale's wording as well.
Can everyone see my screen? I decided just pull up the PowerPoint. I found it.
Okay, yes, we see it.
Yeah, sorry about that. So let me, go over to, the goals. Although it's not going to let me edit in this mode, so hang on. And I can make this the draft for this part. Whatever you guys wanted to add or remove from the goals.
On the slide above.
Yeah, go back to one. Yeah.
Goals one through five. There you go.
So to the reduce crashes, Dale has some language on that.
Yeah. I reduce crashes between vehicles, bikes, and pedestrians.
Among is probably a better term.
What was that?
Among, not among. Between.
It's more than two.
Yeah, I agree.
Oh, I thought you said, gotcha.
Yeah. Now, it's an old story, but when I was in seventh grade, my English teacher approached me because she was also my Spanish teacher. And she looked at me and she said, I don't know why you're taking Spanish. English is already a foreign language.
Okay. Thanks for sharing. Chris Schmaltz.
Yeah, I really like to add to the last bullet goal five, except I would just offer for simplification purposes, dropping off the across the landscape. I think that's implied.
Okay, that's fine.
I'm going to repeat that for her.
Where you're talking about landscape.
Okay, reduce wildlife related crashes and to provide for wildlife connectivity. I mean, it is between habitat blocks, but that's kind of nerdy. So, because we're connecting it to what, but I'm fine. I think that gets the point across.
Yep.
Okay, how does everybody feel about these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 goals? Are there any objections to the language as shown on the screen?
Okay. I do have some additions, and then I think Michael Edmonds just raised his hand.
Oh, I saw that too. Okay.
Michael, do you want to go first since...
Michael?
Yeah, thank you. Mine is real short and sweet. I'd like to offer the word collision in place of crashes, if everyone thinks that's a better term.
Crashes.
Bill, would you go with reduce collisions among...
I would say an incident doesn't often involve a collision. It could be somebody swerves to avoid a collision and they cause a crash. So that would be my take on that.
Okay.
Okay, so which is preferred here?
Sticking with crashes.
Crashes. Okay, back to crashes.
A stronger word.
Yeah, I know. It sounds a lot worse. Okay. Ev, I see your hand up, but Moss, were you wanting to say something as well?
I wanted to make a quick comment about the bullet we're on. Instead of saying among vehicles, bikes, and pedestrians, should we say crashes of all kinds so that we're not like inadvertently leaving out skateboarders or something else that we didn't anticipate?
Well, Dale had mentioned he wanted it to be very clear about that, but we could also say, and others.
Yeah, I'd be very, very comfortable if we want to move the and over and say, and others.
Yeah.
So like bikes, that. Pedestrians, and others.
I like that too.
It's a whale song.
I just have from years of watching bicycle and pedestrian accidents, I really want those words in the goal. Because it's just a terrible problem.
May we say something more like just transportation modalities? Because I think even, preventing crashes between public transportation and other modes of transportation. So would it be enough to kind of say transportation, different transportation modalities?
Right.
I think, was that Justine? Think that some of us really want to see it spelled out with bikes, pedestrians, and others.
Gotcha.
Vehicles would cover buses and other sort of vans, that kind of thing too.
Right.
Yeah.
Deal?
What I was going to say, I think vehicles under, well, if you go back to state law, even a motorcycle is a vehicle. I think vehicles is very comprehensive term, and and bicycles is fine as far as I'm concerned, but I do, it's just an emotional thing with me, I guess. It's just a big problem that we've had in the community, and I think we need to be specific in this case.
Okay, thank you. And then I've got Moss and Justine again, or if your hand is still up, just lower it. But I've got Moss and then, got Moss.
Okay, so for the first bullet, I want to add manage and in front of reduce congestion. So it would read manage and reduce congestion. And then at the end, I think this is where that my noodle from earlier can fit in, after congestion type through demand management strategies and intelligent transportation systems. And then I have another comment for this slide, for a bullet on this slide when we're ready.
Just remember that's not the only way that traditionally we've dealt with congestion. So I think you could say instead of through demand management, you could say including use of
including use of demand management strategies and intelligent transportation systems.
Yeah.
Don't want to leave out getting rid of a lot of the cars.
Yeah, that's good. Yep.
Well, okay. Do we want to have anything in here about limiting road widenings? Because I know that that's also been traditionally a way to, in theory, reduce congestion, although it's been proven to not. So I wonder if we need to be, if we really truly want to reduce congestion, since there's an abundance of evidence that that's not a solution for that, we might want to be explicit here in saying that that does not include road widenings.
I would say that that's going to be decided in the inclusion of the projects that we choose.
I mean, the manage and reduce congestion is a goal, and there are a lot of ways to do it. I don't think we need to get specific. I like adding the demand management strategies and intelligent transportation systems because it's a new technology since 2006 in many ways, but I don't think we want to start listing all of the different ways to reduce and manage congestion in our goals.
Okay.
Was there more, Moss? Or are we?
I can give you another bullet, and if that's helpful. Or I see. Ava.
I have a comment about it. I mean, can we actually include reducing congestion as a goal? I mean, is that something that we can promise our project is going to do? I feel like we can't. I mean, I almost feel like it shouldn't be a goal because we can't ensure that it's actually going to work.
Dale.
Yes, I think we can have it as a goal. It does not mean that it's a goal in every project. You know, we have to think about the fact that we're talking about a plan that covers a broad spectrum of type of urban areas that are different. And so reducing congestion can be a goal, but it's not gonna, there's obviously areas where we've got other limits where adding lanes which is the real quandary here, is not a good idea at this point because we've reached certain limits and we just can't go there to reduce congestion. Other areas, it's going to be because the roadways haven't been developed, whether we talk about the Far East Side or the Northwest Side, et cetera, where adding lanes is going to be the first go-to idea that those communities are going to want to do. And so I think reducing congestion is something we want to do, and there are multiple ways to accomplish that. And we want to make sure, and why I agree with this language, is we want to make sure that including use of demand management strategies and intelligent transportation systems are included and on the list. Too often in the past, adding lanes has been the only solution, and we want other things to be included. And I think this accomplishes that.
Thank you. And I think Moss has one, but let's to finish on this one. I just also wanted to say, we can't promise that we're going to improve transit ridership or even reduce crash. I mean, none of this, these are our goals. So
yeah.
I agree with that. And Moss, I think you said you had another bullet to add.
Just to edit. So it's the second bullet. And what I'm proposing adding is after provide. Is so it would read provide safe, reliable, healthy, and efficient regional mobility for all residents. The concern I have across the region too is that it implies that projects will have to be of a certain scale in mobility, which I think came up in our last conversation. Like, I think interestingly, like Tucson is such, given the footprint of it. Like if there is a project that connects, you know, First Avenue is actually a great example of it, that the majority of it is within the city. So could that potentially, even though it is a key connector from the North Oro Valley, Marana, and other parts of Pima County down to the reservations and such, that I don't want, it's a key corridor, things like that are key projects. And I'm worried that the across the region might kind of junk up that thinking. So, sorry, Pocky. So I'll get back to helping you with this. Safe, reliable, healthy, and efficient regional mobility for all residents, and then take off the across the region.
Madam Chair and members of the committee, this is Chris Schmaltz. I apologize, I have to drop off, but good meeting, I appreciate it. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah, thanks for all your good suggestions, thanks. Okay.
Moss, I know I missed, so provide safe, reliable, healthy, and efficient regional mobility. What was the last part? I'm just highlighting this because I...
No worries, the last bit is just for all residents.
Oh, that's right, for all residents.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Yes, Diane.
I appreciate this language, Moss, but I feel like if we say residents, we're not really thinking about the visitors and the pass-through traffic that comes through our region. I think we need to keep that in mind as well.
What do you think about like all the modes? Or, you know, I'm trying to like just be trying to make sure it's inclusive to, you know, like we want if you're a visitor, we want public transit to be accessible so you don't have to rent a car or, you know, something like that. Or if you're, you know, a bicycle.
Is an inhabitant a transient visitor as well?
We could be even all residents and visitors. I don't know.
Well, just say for users.
I'm willing to say
for users, for all users.
I would rather not have the word all. But
oh, for users or all, yeah, okay.
Users is implied.
Or just stop it after stop regional it. Mobility. That's fine too.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah,
that was my point too.
Who is that, Chris?
Oh, that was Tom. Sorry.
Oh, hi, Tom.
I blurted. I forgot I was unmuted. I think regional essentially satisfies the need for any further, any further wording after it. And it does get confusing when we just add for residents or for users or whatever. I think just efficient regional mobility. Boom.
Boom.
Okay. Well, let's try this out. How about, are there any objections to the language of the bullets on the screen currently? Okay, those are done. Now we've got another few pages, don't we? Of
you have four more goals.
Okay, actually, these are the last ones, I think. Okay, yep. Anyway, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Pocky.
No, this is the last of the 10. Improve conditions of existing roadways. Provide safer bicycle and pedestrian facilities. There were no changes to those. Improve air quality was revised. Access to workplaces. Improve air quality was revised from maintain and improve.
There are a couple more that are on this page about the key commerce corridors and enhancing health through active transportation. That was on the next slide. Okay.
Yeah, these are the next one will are additional ones. These were just the ones, the original.
Okay, I'm sorry. I thought you said that was all. Okay, is everybody?
Oh, sorry, yeah.
Are there any changes or Diane?
I'd like to suggest the fourth one, improve access to workplaces, is a little too specific because if it's to destinations, because that could be a school, that could be work, that could be a common public space. So I'm wondering if workplaces is too specific.
Yeah, I think that, as I recall, there was a very specific want to talk about workplaces that I can't recall. It was so long ago. Dale.
My recollection, and it is just a recollection, I don't have nothing in writing, is that that was really an early attempt to get to Mr. Wright's desires with key commerce corridors. And frequently in planning, actually access to workplaces is a planning concept of people. PAG does look at that issue, and I think it might be able to consolidate with some comments on the workplace corridors. But I was looking at the comments about the key corridors under ADOT. Basically, we have two roadways in the system that have are commerce corridors according to ADOT, and that's I-10 and I-19. As somebody who's spent years working in and around the restaurant industry, I can tell you there's a hell of a lot of trucks on the city streets going to various restaurants. That's, you know, and you could talk about other issues with, you know, getting products in and around the community. But when we look at, you know, the truck limitations and where trucks can go and everything, it is a serious issue when you get into restaurants and those things that are integrated into our community that also have big trucks coming and in to bring product in frequently from warehouses in Phoenix. And they will tell the restaurant that they won't deliver to them if there's no way for them to get a truck there. And I think the key commerce corridors concept needs development, and I'm not sure how to do that here. But I could, you know, that's just my comments about it that I thought about. And unfortunately, I didn't come up with a real solution wording because it's a very awkward thing to do.
Okay, another time check. It is a couple of minutes after 1 o'clock. Is everybody willing to stay and hammer out these last couple? If so, we'll keep moving. Okay, so improve access to workplaces. Oh, I'm sorry, there are some hands up. Moss, and then Eva, and then Rachel.
Dale, I just wanted to say I really appreciate your comments on in expanding, and Dan, I think expanding this from workplace. I don't have a total solution to the workplace. One thing I jotted down was improve multimodal performance of key corridors, maybe we can also make it then access to, you know, key destinations or something like that.
Yeah, my comment is actually along the same lines. Improve access to workplaces, medical care, education, and other key services, something along those lines. Because also in terms of equity, there are studies that show that minority populations are more likely to be cut off from their jobs, from doctors, friends, family, and different services. So if we can, you know, just acknowledge that workplace connectivity is important as well as other key services, I think that could do us some good.
Okay, is there some exact wording that you just, that you could give to Pocky?
Yeah, we could do improve accesses to workplaces, medical care, education, and other key services.
Okay.
I also wanted to mention too, in terms of the air quality, we said that we were going to move quality from the priorities into the goals. So improve air quality would change to improve quality of air, water, and wildlife habitat.
Is that correct?
Water's
missing.
Improve air quality. Yeah, if you change it to improve quality of air, water, and wildlife habitat. That's it.
Okay, and then before Dale wants to say something, but was there something else to that improve multi-corridor phrase at the very, is that another bullet or was that?
I thought Moss had started another one, but maybe I misunderstood.
Yeah. I think it's really related to that one with the workplaces. So we could maybe blend it together, but what the words I included were improve multimodal performance. And then it could be like
multimodal. Write it and then you guys tell me.
Sure, thanks. Thanks, Pocky.
No, that way you can see it.
Yeah.
Improve multimodal performance.
And then I think where I would see it fitting with the other one, if other folks agree, would be just to move the multimodal performance in front of access to workplace medical care, education, and other key services or and or destinations, however we kind of land there. Yeah.
Keep access and access. Okay. Dale, and then I have Rachel.
Okay. When we're using the term multimodal, and you know, I know sometimes that has multiple definitions. Are we implying that when we say multimodal, that it includes everything from trucks to bicycles and pedestrians?
Yes, that's how I would interpret it. Yeah. Thanks for the clarification.
Okay, and I think destinations is now removed from that phrase. Yes,
I'd like to say key destinations, since we're talking about transportation, we're not necessarily talking about the services. Does that make sense?
I'm sorry, repeat.
So are we trying to get access to key services or key destinations which would provide the services?
It sounds like we're specifying that we want access to those workplaces, medical care, key services. Those are all key services.
I do want to say I do like that idea of changing services to destinations because it's more capacious. You know, well-being also includes access to public parks and things like that that aren't really services. So I like actually the idea of replacing services with destinations.
I'm comfortable with that.
Okay, sounds like there's some heads nodding. And then Rachel, did you still have?
Yeah. Yes, thank you. I just wanted to add, I know we can't list all destinations here, but I think it's important that we add food into a key destination just based on how difficult it is for some people to get to grocery stores. And if we explicitly say that, I'm hoping that there will be enough, you know, that we will take that into account when we're evaluating projects.
So education, comma, grocery stores?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so can everyone see the wording on the screen? Are there any objections to the language as shown on the screen currently?
Just the last bullet to clarify, or are we talking about all of them?
No, just the 1, 2, 3, 4 that are on here.
I have a couple other suggestions for edits on the first two bullets, if this is the time.
Do you mean improve the conditions of existing roadways and the bicycle and pedestrian?
Yes, I do. I have some.
Okay.
So it'd be, for the first one, it'd be improve conditions of all existing transportation infrastructure, recognizing that, you know, like transit systems are not just the roads. I want to try to I think the Dale point that Dale's been making, bringing up all day, is trying to make sure that it's explicitly expansive beyond personal vehicles.
Okay.
And so then we'd get rid of roadways.
Okay, just let me just halt. Okay, because we're getting close to not having a quorum here. Okay. Yes. Go ahead.
And then the last thing would be for the provide safer for the second bullet, provide safer, comma, more connected bicycle and pedestrian facilities.
Okay.
And the only thing I was going to add to the improve air quality of air, water, and wildlife would was also to include reducing vehicle miles traveled and greenhouse gases.
On that bullet, you want and or by and reduce?
Greenhouse gas emissions and vehicle miles traveled. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, is everybody comfortable, or should I say, does anybody object to the language as we see it now?
I think the roadways is supposed to be deleted.
Roadways yeah. deleted.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure everyone had a chance to agree on that before I remove.
Okay.
I would take out the word all against it.
Roadways is going away.
Yes, okay. So I do not hear any objections to that. And then I'm not sure those couple more on the next page, Paki.
Yep. So this was something that you had talked about at the last meeting, add functionality to key corridors. So you talked a little bit about that today, that you would decide on adding the concept of key commerce corridors. And then also you decide on whether to add a goal of enhancing health through active transportation. Those are some comments we picked up from your last conversations. This was from 2 meetings ago because we didn't discuss this last meeting.
But right now it says add functionality to key corridors. That's our last goal.
Correct? That's the last goal, correct. I'm
okay.
The last slide because I didn't have room.
Any discussion about these? Well, this one here.
Is it necessary any longer? And I feel bad that Bruce is probably the most wise yes. speaking to this. But I wonder if that last the edits to that last bullet address this e-commerce issue. But yeah. To me, it feels like it, but I'm not Bruce.
Well, I remember when that was added, add functionality to key corridors pretty much covers it all. That's what I think.
Yes. My comment here is that I think it's covered. I think we'll probably hear from Bruce if he doesn't think it is.
Yes, or he may never show up again. Okay, so then the last one I believe was from Eva.
Yes, I just wanted to say, I also agree. I feel like key commerce corridors is pretty much included now. I would like to still see the inclusion of enhancing health through active transportation. It could be added if we wanted to, there was a place I was seeing. No, maybe not.
I mean, I think with the wordsmithing we've done on others, hopefully that's included, but if you disagree.
I thought maybe it was, but now I don't see a place where it is actually. Oh, here it was. This is what I was thinking, is that provide safer bicycle and pedestrian facilities or otherwise enhancing active transportation options.
This one here, Eva?
Mm-hmm. Let me see. Yes, mm-hmm. Right at the end of that.
Can you repeat it again?
Provide safer, more connected bicycle and pedestrian facilities or otherwise enhancing health through active transportation options. And we could, and after you put it down, I can cut it back a little more too.
Enhancing health.
Health through active transportation options.
I mean, to me, it implies that. I mean, they're bicycle and pedestrian are the active. I mean, are there other ones?
Okay, could you go back one slide? I thought we had another goal similar to that.
Yeah, provide safe, reliable, healthy, and efficient regional mobility.
Yeah.
Yes, health is mentioned twice, so.
Kevin.
I was just going to suggest we could just revise it to provide safer, more connected bicycle pedestrian facilities or otherwise enhance or otherwise enhanced active transportation options or opportunities.
I like that.
Did you say options?
Or either that or opportunities, whatever it looks like better.
I'll vote for options just so we make a decision.
I'm comfortable with that.
Okay, so I guess back to that other slide. Is everybody, are there any objections to what's on the previous slide that we just edited a bit? Okay, good. And then the last, back to the last one. Are we done? Is everybody fine with just this last, keeping this last bullet as is, add functionality to key corridors?
I just pop in multimodal functionality just to keep in the spirit of everything that Dale's been really well stating.
Multimodal functionality.
Thank you.
And I think it means more than that too. As I recall when Rick gave us that presentation, but okay. Are there any objections to that? Okay. I'm not even going to ask for any more goals that people have come up with.
This one can be then, you've taken care of it then.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
All right.
I agree.
I'll remove it. Just wanted to make.
And remove everything after.
Actually, do something else. Okay. I'll take care of it. I'll know what that means for me. Okay, and then that's it.
Okay, now we have the review of jurisdiction priorities. What do you need, an hour?
Round off a little bit.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I believe you do not have a quorum anymore. If you don't mind, let's double check.
Oh, okay. I thought we had checked because Diane left, but she's on Zoom now.
You just lost her.
Oh. Okay. The meeting, I guess we're going to just adjourn the meeting. Okay. Well, thanks for everybody.
Future agenda items. We need future agenda items.
No, once there's no quorum, the meeting has to adjourn.
Yeah, we can't meet any longer now. It's over.
But you still have the option to email me or Pocky if you have items for agendas. We always have that option. So make sure you do that.
Okay. And I just want to thank the chair for letting me take the easiest meeting of all time and chair it. I really appreciate it, Tom.
You earned it.
Okay, thank you, everybody.
She's not sarcastic.